Dawn to a Greater Dawn in Telugu, and several other books. She is a regular contributor to Akhila, the Telugu version of Sri Aurobindo Society's All India magazine. Well, friends, the message for today's special occasion: Mother, be with me now and always. Envelop me with your presence. Raise and purify me with your touch. Inhabit me with your living image. Transform all dullness and darkness into bright and perfect faith. Transform all restlessness and agitation into inviolable calm and peace. Transform all attachment into a deep and stainless purity. Mother, liberate and change me. Perfect your child. By Sri Aurobindo. Well, friends, our next program will be on February 28th, Wednesday, 50th anniversary of Auroville Day. We'll be having a video presentation on Auroville, Integral Yoga and the Future of Mankind by Sri Shraddhalu Ranade from 5 to 6:30 p.m. in Cultural Hall. All are welcome. With these few words, I hand over the session to our speaker. Thank you.
Anandamayi Chaitanyamayi Satyamayi Parame Om Namo Bhagavate Sri Aravindaya. Om Meera Sri Aravindo. Open my mind, my heart, my body to your light, your love and your power. May I see the divine in all things. Today on this beautiful occasion, on Mother's birthday, amongst all the affectionate people of Bangalore who are within the society and outside also, I am happy to be here. I am happy to participate in this celebration in a small way, offering my words at the lotus feet of Mother as an offering, as a gift to her on her birthday. It is my birthday gift. It is a simple, soulful talk that is not of any great knowledge or anything, but the simple experiences of spirituality and about Savitri. I am going to speak about great vision of Ashwapati and the boon he has given us from his tapas we have. So, let us start. What is Ashwapati's yoga and vision? We have to go into the background of the entire second book, where Ashwapati's entire traveling is his own spiritual experience. He has transcended individual, universal self, and he has attained that fulfillment. Again, coming to the next this thing for the vision and boon, Ashwapati actually did not satisfy anything but a complete change of the human race. Actually, he wants to uplift the entire humanity. For that, his penance is a deeper one, actually. Not individual fulfillment, he did not he was not happy with that one. Again he started to understand the whole mechanism of the creation, and between matter and spirit he has get into the deeper layers of that understanding. And at one time, actually, he and the world united. The whole world is there in his voice, is there in his penance. It's not an individual choice. It is for the human beings he was doing the tapas. So for that, a world desire compelled her mortal birth, says Sri Aurobindo. The avatar to come, it is a world desire actually. Every human being on this earth was calling the force to come, because the time has come for a change. So every human soul is singing a song, a soulful song, a cry from the deeper layers of their hearts to come down. So that joined Aswapati is the whole band of human cry, the soulful cry of the human beings joined Aswapati's aspiration. So it became ardent, intense, a deeper aspiration for the whole humanity. It is not a single person doing this tapas. It is the entire humanity through him. He was such a open and a colonist of immortality, says Sri Aurobindo. So he is such a great forerunner of the human race. And his aspiration was so great that Divine Mother has to come. So that was the aspiration of King Aswapati, which is of course Sri Aurobindo's himself. The aspiration is his. Aswapati is the representative of the entire humanity. He is the forerunner. He is a lover of humanity, a seeker of divine truth. After attaining individual universal realizations, he experienced an inner vision, a darshan. A form appears, the beauty and power of the Supreme Mother. He realized that the total negation to free the self, though it is great by itself, is not for him. It is not for his own liberation. He wants to complete the desire of the God. What is the desire of the God? Here Sri Aurobindo says, here to fulfill himself is God's desire. God wanted to see a fulfillment in each and every being on the earth where he is residing. In every being there is a soul, there is a spirit. So he wants that every spirit should be realized, fulfilled. So that he wants to see. His transformation of earth he wants to see. That is actually, and again one have to see that what Aswapati is actually, his great qualities. He is a great visionary. Again, let us go to the textbook. After all these experiences, when he comes to the, before the darshan actually, he has adored, that he has given an adoration to the Divine Mother. Something in him, from the soul itself, a prayer comes out. A presence he felt, something, a power and presence before him, which is from the inner core, he has seen a presence of the Divine Mother, and how it, the Supreme Mother, and then he offered a prayer, which is very important for us. From that we go into the boon and this thing. A burning love from wide spiritual founts annulled the sorrow of the ignorant depths. Suffering was lost in her immortal smile. A life from beyond grew conqueror here of death. To err no more was natural to mind. Wrong could not come where all was light and love. The formless and the formed were joined in her. Immensity was exceeded by a look. A face revealed the crowded infinite, incarnating inexpressibly in her limbs. The boundless joy, the blind world forces seek. Her body of beauty moon the seas of bliss. At the head she stands of birth and toil and fate. In their slow round the cycles turn to her call. Alone her hands can change time's dragon base. Hers is the mystery the night conceals. The spirit's alchemist energy is hers. She is the golden bridge, the wonderful fire. the luminous heart of the unknown history, a power of silence in the depths of God. She is the force, the inevitable word, the magnet of our difficult ascent, the sun from which we kindle all our suns, the light that leans from the unrealized was, the joy that beckons from the impossible, the might of all that never yet came down. All nature dumbly calls to her alone, to heal with her feet the aching throb of life, and break the seals and the dim soul of man, and kindle her fire in the closed heart of things. All here shall be one day her sweetness home, all contraries prepare her harmony, towards her our knowledge climbs, our passion gropes. In her miraculous rapture we shall dwell, her clasp shall turn to ecstasy our pain, our self shall be oneself with all through her. In her confirmed because transformed in her, our life shall find in its fulfilled response above the boundless hush beatitudes, below the wonder of the embrace divine, this known as in a thunder flash of God, the rapture of things eternal filled his limbs, amazement fell upon his ravished sense, his spirit was caught in her intolerant flame. Once seen, his heart acknowledged only her, only a hunger of infinite bliss was left, all aims in her were lost, then found in her, his base was gathered to one pointing spike. This he has experienced, this beautiful prayer. Every time everybody reads this one and enjoys the presence of the Mother, the divine presence actually. So now only a hunger of infinite bliss was left in Ashwapati. Nothing, he wants only her, nothing else. The divine supreme Mother, he wants it, but nothing else. So such a vast surrender and appreciation of the bliss and power. All aims in her were lost. Now there is no aim but that. He wants to see her. He wants to experience her power. He wants to experience her bliss. So nothing is there in him. Then his base was gathered to one pointing spire. He is that fire actually, that fire going above and above. So this was the mood of Ashwapati when he was adoring the Divine Mother. So he has seen the presence, not the full darshan is not there, but it is palpable, some presence is there, a power is there near. So he experienced this one. Why I am telling this is, after this there is something Sri Aurobindo is telling in this, the canto is ending here, what we have to do, why Ashwapati got it, actually had the darshan, afterwards we will see that Ashwapati had the darshan. So how could the aspiration was answered in Ashwapati. How he has prepared his ground, how he has toiled to get it, how deep was his penance, all these are the questions, because every wish is not answered by the divine. Which is ardent, which is intense, which is sincere, which is real, that only has an answer from the divine higher life. So here we have to see how Ashwapati at that time, what he is. And in a general way, Sri Aurobindo says here for everybody, bring into life's closed rooms the immortal's air and fill the finite with the infinite. For that, what we have to do? There is a great lesson here. All that denies must be torn out and slain. All that denies must be torn out and slain, and crushed the many longings for whose sake we lose the one for whom our lives were made. Now other claims had hushed in him their cry, only he longed to draw her presence and power into his heart and mind and breathing frame. Only he yearned to call forever down her healing touch of love and truth and joy into the darkness of the suffering world. His soul was freed and given to her alone. This is actually the inner space that has to be like this only. We have to create such an inner space if we want the divine to reside inside. all the denies must be torn out and slain, which denies the spirit must be torn out and slain, he says, and crushed the many longings for whose sake the so many tapatriyas, the life's yearnings and all the desires, all the kamanas, we lose the one for whom our lives were made. For all those mundane things, material things, or whatever it may be, very, very small pleasures of life, we lose the one. Because the true purpose we lose by being indulged in this common, so superficial frontal being is missing all these things. So a deeper learning, a deeper understanding of the soul is very, very essential, and a cleansing of your inner space and a turning towards inside, an antarmukha, is very, very important to have a divine understanding of the spirit. Actually, to understand the spirit and its inner meaning, we have to clean everything inside. The inner being must be offered with a very pure atmosphere. We lose the one for whom our lives were made. So what happened for Ashwapati now? Because he was like that. Now other claims had hushed in him in their cry. No more ordinary cry is there. It is all hushed. It is peaceful there. Only he longed to draw her presence and power. He wants only that power and presence to be always with him, into his heart and mind and breathing frame. So we have to take that power, to allow that power to work in us. So our heart should be open, our mind should be ready, and our frame, entire frame, that is the mental, physical things, all these are to be open and ready. Only he yearned to call forever down her healing touch of love and truth and joy. Really, it is the only necessity for the entire world, for each human being, her healing touch. For that only we are all aspiring, for that healing touch, love, that pure love. Ordinary human love is not sufficient for us. The divine love, which is pure, that gives us the satisfaction and that gives us the solace, comfort of the inner, this thing, feelings. A healing touch of love and truth and joy, and the truth also. We cannot find a truth that is as good as that divine truth. No, here the truth is always distorted. So that truth, we want that truth. Asalena, this very, very truth of existence. Into the darkness of the suffering world. Again, the world is suffering because of this ignorance, because of this impurities. His soul was freed and given to her alone. Now he has given everything to him. When you offer the soul, there is nothing to offer actually. The soul is the only thing to offer. The outwardly, whatever you offer, there is no value. Only if you offer your soul, even when you are ordinarily also, when we are present with somebody, when your soul is open, that is a true connection actually. Without offering one's heart and soul, there is no connection actually. We just say hello or we just talk, but that is all superficial and outwardly only. But the inner connection is only soul to soul, Atma Bandhu. Only when one is connected through the soul, though physically you may not be near, but the soul, when it is connected, that is the eternal actually relationship with anybody. That in a relationship lasts forever. So such way he has given everything to her alone. That was the preparation of the adoration and preparation actually. That was the condition of Ashwapati before he getting the vision and boon. That's why I was very particular to present this one. Now we are going into actual vision and the boon. Here the Divine Supreme Mother is also very intelligent. We need not say that. Her prajna is 100,000 fold better than a human being, though he did lot of penance. He gives his own reasons. Ashwapati start giving his own reasons. Please come, you have to come here, no other than you. Your entire essence has to come onto this earth, your entire power, you have to come. In fact, the Supreme Mother has to descend and take a human form, he requests. And then he say, she also, her logic and her ideas she puts forth. Though this is not the time, she goes on telling that about the imperfections of earth, imperfections of human being, and the time is not ready. But after a long talk, then actually Vasupati could make her give the promise. Actually, he received the boon and promise from her. So the process we have to see now. What happens afterwards is when Vasupati is keeping his fire and he is silent in Sri Aurobindo or in any sacred this thing yogi is offering. So we see that silence is everything there. The silence is the sole power of creation, because it is silent, it could create. So that silence, immense silence and a fire inside is the now the state of Aswapati. Then suddenly there rose a sacred still. In between he was in a different kind of state actually. That I am not going to discuss now. After that again he has realized that his wish is different actually. He wants that he has to combine earth and heaven, and humanity, the matter and spirit should go in hand in hand. He wants that part of tapas he wants to attain actually, to change the earth consciousness, to change the human consciousness. That was his main aim, not his soul liberation or nirvana. So again he started keeping his fire awake, and he is in silence. Then something stir in him. Amid the lifeless silence of the void, in a solitude and an immensity, a sound came quivering like a loud footfall. Now he is listening to the footfall of the charana sparsa of something. The divine has to come, something has to come, some power presence again he is inviting through his fire, his silence. Suddenly he heard something, some footprints are coming, footfall is coming, that beautiful steps of the mother. Actually he wants that her charana sparsa has to change the entire world with her beautiful the touch. Heard in the listening spaces of the soul. Again, everything is inside only. The darshana is also the inner darshan. This is antar darshana, nothing outside. His soul is only experiencing all these things. Even the vision also coming inside him, this inner space, heart and soul. A touch perturbed his fibers with delight. There is delight everywhere. His soul is touched. Every fiber and nerve is receiving that delight in him. Delight of the presence of some beyond. An influence had approached the mortal range. A boundless heart was near his longing heart. His heart is ready to receive the boundless heart of the divine. A mystic form enveloped his earthly shape. All at her contact broke from silent seal. Spirit and body thrilled, identified, linked in the grasp of an unspoken joy. Mind, members, life were merged in ecstasy. Now everything in him, the mind, body, heart, everything is ready to receive that ecstasy of the approaching divine. Intoxicated as with nectarious rain, something is pouring on him. Some beautiful nectarious delight is encompassing him. Something coming from the down, from the upwards on his. Intoxicated as with nectarious rain, his nature's fashioning stretches float to her, flashing with lightnings, mad with luminous wine. All was a limitless sea that heaved to the moon, as if the sea is a limitless sea is heaving to the moon. A beautiful picture by Sri Aurobindo. A limitless sea is heaving to the moon. It's enjoying that waves are touching the moon actually. A divinizing stream possesses his veins. There is some, everything is flowing in him, the divinizing stream. All is turned into such a beautiful nectar within him. His body's cells awoke to spirit sense. Now his body's cells are receiving the soul sparsa, the spirit sense. It's no more a material body. It is receiving all the divine elements. Each nerve became a burning thread of joy. So vividly Sri Aurobindo describes, each nerve has been transformed into a beautiful thread of joy. Each, how beautiful it will be, no? We are all suffering with all these ordinary these things, but with tapas everything can happen. That is what Asopati Yoga says. Tissue and flesh partook beatitude. Everything is partaking in that beatitude, that beautiful this thing, delight. Allied the dun unplumbed subconscious chaos, thrilled with the prescience of her longed for tread. And even the subconscious chaos also, all those regions are waiting for her to come and tread on their way. And filled with flickering crests and praying tongues, everybody, everything is praying actually, everything is praying there. Even lost in slumber, mute, inanimate, his very body answered to her power. The one he worshipped was within him now. Now the whole goddess is now within him. Now the entire body of the divine supreme mother, the entire darshan is there inside him. The spaces is in his inner spaces is containing the whole picture of the Murti, entire murti of the divine supreme mother is there. Adela, how is it? The one he worshipped was within him now. Flame pure, ethereal crest, a mighty face. There are no words actually. I cannot describe. I am lack of so many these things now. Flame pure, it is the Suddha, Sweta, pure light actually. It's a pure jyoti, pure jwala. A very pure, ethereal crest, a mighty face, a face that is mighty. Sakti Matala, it's like might. Appeared and lips moved by mortal words, and her lips are moved with immortal words. Even the words are Amaravaku, the pure, beautiful words of the divine. Leads wisdom leaves, wisdom's leaves drooped over rapturous orbs. A marble monument of pondering shone, a forehead's side script and large like ocean's gaze. Even her forehead with cryptic messages which are mystery, mystic language actually. There is something that is covered there which we cannot read. There is some powerful language is there. Towards heaven, two tranquil eyes of boundless thought looked into man's and saw the God to come. So this always we use it and with mother's calendars. No? Towards heaven, two tranquil eyes of boundless thought looked into man's and saw the God to come. A shape was seen on threshold mind, a voice absolute and wise in the heart's chamber spoke. Now he is listening a voice from inside only, it is coming as an antar vani, it's coming. Now the Divine Mother is speaking through him. He is listening the voice. He has seen the picture. Now he is hearing the voice. What she says now, we will see. O son of strength, who climbest creation speaks. No soul is thy companion in the light. Alone thou standest at the eternal doors. What thou hast won is thine, but ask no more. She started. She is very intelligent. O son of strength, who climbest creation speaks. You are now, you have climbed the peaks of creation. Now you are at the, at the zenith. Zenith of creation. Alone thou standest at the eternal doors. Now you are at the near the eternal doors. What thou hast won is thine, but ask no more. Okay, you have reached this far and you have seen me. It's enough. Be satisfied with that one, but ask no more. It is readily telling that his hair this thing. O spirit aspiring in an ignorant frame, again she started telling him. O voice arisen from the inconscient world, she is telling him. O spirit aspiring in an ignorant frame, for Asopati she is telling that ignorant frame, the material, the matter, the sheets are the ignorant frame. O spirit aspiring, but your spirit is aspiring, you are a human. Again she is telling that you are a human being with a spirit, aspiring spirit inside. Like, O voice arisen from the inconscient world. So your voice is arising from the inconscient world. How shalt thou speak for men whose hearts are dumb? This is what the state of affairs now she is giving us. How shalt thou speak for men whose hearts are dumb? Here on earth, everybody is dumb for my words. They don't want to hear me. They don't want to see me. So why should come like that? How shalt thou speak? Why you are speaking for them on behalf of the men who are not at all listening to anything sacred? They are not waiting for me. They are not for me at all. They are not listening. They are indifferent to my presence. Then why should I come? That is why. How shalt thou speak for men whose hearts are dumb? Make for blind earth the soul's seer vision's home, or lighten the burden of the senseless globe. Lighten the burden of the senseless globe. I am the mystery beyond reach of mind. Now she has stated that. I am the mystery beyond reach of mind. Where there is totally a rule of the mind, I cannot come. Because it's a, I am a mystery which the mind cannot bear. Mind cannot bear the presence of my strength, my vision and my light. You cannot take it. I am the goal of the travail of the sense. She says about herself. Now, what you think that because of me, the entire sun, the suryas, the mandalas are roaming. The whirling, the globes are there because of me. So many suns are going through the cosmos because of me. So I am the cause of those suryas. My fire and sweetness are the cause of life. Because of me, my Agni, my Chitagni, that is the cause of life. Because of my Chitchakti, life is there. The sweetness, even the Madhurya, whatever sweetness you are enjoying through life, sweetness is also there in life, no? With suffering parallel, we are having that sweetness of life. That's why we want to live. Because of that sweetness only, man wants to live with all the problems. Because there is sweetness in life, definitely. Why not? We are all experiencing that from our childhood to our old age. We are experiencing every day that sweetness is also there. My fire and sweetness are the cause of life. But again she warns now, she gives a warning. But too immense my danger and my joy. But my danger, when I am not happy, if I want to do something with when I am not happy, if I create something, my danger, that is also very problematic. You cannot face the danger. And my joy, even joy, when it is too immense, even joy you cannot take. Both are the things that you have to be cautious, she says. Awake not the immeasurable descent. Now I am quietly, happily there in the heavens. Don't call me down. Because if I come there will be problem. Mother also used to say like that. Awake not the immeasurable descent. Now don't ask me to come down. Don't ask for the avarohana. Please wait. Have this fun for some time. Some more time you enjoy this fun of this kayas. So she says, wait for me. Don't ask me to come now. Awake not the immeasurable descent. Speak not my secret name to hostile time. Here again she is telling time is always hostile. Time is not always congenial for human being. It's not every time it is not doing good or something. There are problems with time. Time takes its own course. She will not bother. Nothing bothers. Time takes its own way. It goes its own way. So speak not my secret name to hostile time. So my rahasya, my name, don't tell her. Tell the time. Man is too weak to bear the infinite's weight. So man cannot take the burden of the infinite. When I come, there is so much you have to take. There are so many demands for the divine. No, you cannot be in an ordinary way. You have to be a little, in order. You have to keep your mind, your source, everything in a divine preparation. You have to be purified by yourself. You have to be ready to enjoy the infinite things. So now it is difficult for the man to take the burden. Truth born too soon might break the imperfect earth. When it is not ready, when there is too much of imperfection, truth cannot be sustained here. Truth cannot take its full course. Leave the all-seeing power to hew its way. So leave it to me, the whole all-seeing power. I will see what to do, when to do, and please leave it to me. In thy single vast achievement, reign apart. Now she is advising. You have achieved something. Soulfully, solely, alone, you have achieved a major task. But now, helping the world with thy great lonely days. Again, she is giving him a work to do. Help the world. Now that is your mission, to help the world. I ask thee not to melt thy heart of flame in thy mobile's wide unfailing bliss. Don't ask a solitary bliss for you. Don't ask for that liberation. Work, be here on the earth field and work. In the immobile's wide uncaring bliss, I ask thee not to make thy heart a flame. Turn from the fruitless motion of the years, deserting the fierce labor of the worlds. Again she is telling, don't desert the world. Be in the world and work for the world. Aloof from beings, lost in thy alone. Don't do that. How shall thy mighty spirit brook repose while death is still unconquered on the earth and time a field of suffering and pain? Now, people like you on earth, they need you, because still the inconscient is ruling the earth. Still death is there. Lot of problems are there on earth. So, souls like you, mighty souls like Ashwapati and the other such saints are needed on the earth. So, and time a field of suffering and pain. So now you are required here. Thy soul was born to share the laden force. Obey thy nature and fulfill thy fate. Your fate has to be fulfilled by working on earthly ways. Accept the difficulty and godlike toil. Again, she is interesting. The toil is not simple. It is a godlike toil. You have to take the burden single-handedly and you have to work out the mission of the earth. Accept the difficulty and godlike toil. For the slow-paced, omniscient purpose live. You only live for the... It is slow-paced, she has given. It is omniscient purpose is... For the omniscient purpose, you live for that sarva-vijna, the purpose of the divine, that is. So you live for that purpose, but that purpose that goes in a slow way. The pace is very slow, but don't bother. You work. The enigma's knot is tied in humankind. They have to remove their own enigma. There is a knot in the humankind, but the human being has to unknot that enigma. He has to remove the riddle. A lightning from the heights that think and plan, plowing the air of life with vanishing trails. Man, soul awake in an unconscious world, aspires in vain to change the cosmic dream. Arrived from some half-luminous beyond, he is a stranger in the mindless vast, a traveler in his oft-shifting home. Here he has written about, she is telling about the about man and his history, how he has to change his life every time. There is a new body, new house, and even new address. Everything is changing for the human being. It's not permanent. It is not eternal. But eternally he has to move. He has to move to solve his this thing, his evolution. A progressive way he has to go. He is a stranger in the mindless past, a traveler in his oft-shifting home, amid the tread of many infinities. He has pitched a tent of life in desert space. Heaven's fixed regard beholds him from above, in the house of nature a perturbing guest, a voyager betwixt thoughts in constant stores, a hunter of unknown and beautiful powers, a nomad of the far mysterious light, in the wide ways, little spark of God. Against his spirit, all is in dire league. This is again, we are warning. So, against his spirit, all is in dire league. Everything works against his spirit only. If you want to have a spiritual life, or you want to work out your spirit's problem, so many problems will come before you. Because there is always a battle between the spirit and matter. There is always a battle. So many problems, dire league will surround him. A Titan influence stops his Godward gaze. Astonishing. So whenever you look upwards, urdhvamukha, whenever you look upwards, there is something that is pulling you back. A Titan influence, that is the Titan influence, the Prabhava is so much that you cannot bear it. Again you come down with thousandfold this thing, and again you forget about the upward gaze. So that is the human life. Whenever you want to have a upward look, something pulls you back into this world. Around him hungers the unpitying void. The eternal darkness seeks him with her hands. Inscrutable energies drive him and deceive. Immense, implacable deities oppose. There is so much that opposes the human victory, or that spirit's victory, actually. So much is in opposition. Like our parties, so much is in opposition. Always something obstructs your journey. An inert soul and a somnambulist force have made a world estranged from life and thought. The dragon of the dark foundations keeps unalterable the law of chance and death. On his long way through time and circumstance, the grey-hued riddling nether shadow sphinx, a dreadful pass upon the swallowing sands, awaits him armed with the soul-slaying word. Across his path sits the dim camp of night. His days, here again some beautiful lines are coming, which are practically applicable to us. His day is a movement in perpetual time. He is the prey of the minutes and hours. Assailed on earth and unassured of heaven, descended here unhappy and sublime. He is both sublime and unhappy, man. Itanlone, there is something sublime is there. Again he is unhappy. Assailed on earth and unassured of heaven. He is here on earth, but he is not sure about the heaven also. We are always in, and say there is something is lacking actually. There is no purity in human life. Again this way or that way. There is always something lacking. His day is a movement in perpetual time. He is the prey of the minutes and the hours. Minutes and hours will take our life as they wish. Time goes on working the human destiny. Again she says, there's so much importance is there, because what are our words? These are the warnings of the Divine Mother, and Sri Aurobindo has written through his experience of the vision. So these lines are very, very important for us. They are telling us how to deal with this matter and how to live a spiritual life, how to improve ourselves, and what are the limitations the Divine Mother herself is saying about human life on earth. A link between the demigod and the beast. So what is man is? He is in between the demigod and the beast. He knows not his own greatness nor his aim. We are great. There is a greater being in us, but we never know that one. Because we live on the surface, we never understand the deeper meaning of our lives, which there is high potential is there, higher aspirations are there. We cannot see our own aspirations sometimes. The whole life will go away. But you do have sometimes a glimpse of higher aspiration, a glimpse of some divine spark in us. There is something latent in us, something is burning inside, but we never bother to think about it. Instead, we want to get away from that, because we cannot, alone we cannot do, there are so many limitations that she herself is telling. So instead of going deeper into that one, sometimes even I have experienced, there is some spark of the divine, do this one, do that one. But immediately, because of the lack of the cooperation or whatever it may be in the surroundings, in the life itself, life has to give you an opportunity, you know. Then you simply leave it like that. You just don't bother to think about it more and do it in a way that you have to do. You don't have that courage to do, actually. You are lacking that courage, resources, a fear. Maybe we fail, or somebody may not give us resources or allow us to do. So these limitations always may kill the spark in us. Sometimes I feel so. But even then, what is possible in our own way? How much ever little it is possible, it allows, the circumstances allow us to do, that we have to do. Then I understood in my own life. Don't leave it like that, but you take up. And in a small way you start, whatever you do, with your own resources, whatever small it may be. Maybe you are not in this life, do that giant work, but you start with little by little, step by step, and one day your psychic being will take you to that state of mind, that state of the soul presence. Then you will continue it. It's a continuation. Because of Sri Aurobindo, I understood that it is a continuation. You start now and it will continue. Your work will continue. It's a progressive evolution. The psychic being is evolving through that only. By taking experiences, it evolves. And the fragrance is there. From every life, it counts all the fragrance, and everything is linking, a chain. Then it will come into a great this thing, aspiration. So that is the journey. Then I thought, don't bother. Whatever little you want to do, you start with it. He knows not his own greatness nor his aim. He has forgotten why he has come and whence. These are the questions really bother us sometimes, no? When you are in a spiritual quest, all these questions bother us. What is existence? Why we are here? Why we are dying? Why there is decay? Why so many whys are there in life, human life? He knows not his own greatness nor his aim. He has forgotten why he has come and whence. His spirit and his members are at war. This I experience daily. His spirit and his members are at war. Always spirit says good things. Spirit says teaches us harmony. Spirit doesn't allow anything to come and spoil. The entire equilibrium is there when you are working from the spirit. But the other members are at war. Spirit says one thing, the other members of the body, that is mind, body, all these things, they tell a different story. So always that conflict is there. That's why it is Kurukshetra. A battle always is on between the spirit and matter. Within the person and outside the person also, in the whole earth. That is the only battle between gods and demons. Everywhere the matter and spirit is in war. His heights break off too low to reach the skies. That is also there. Always we think of so many high things, but again we will fall under the ground. Again immediately, after a point of time, we just lose interest and we cannot sustain the continuity. So many people, it happens also. We have to learn through some people only who work diligently, who are having that, you know, steel like this, you know, purpose and strong. So such people only can do what actually the spirit says. But for ordinary mortals, it is very difficult to follow the spirit. His spirit and his members are at war. His heights break off too low to reach the skies. His moss is buried in the animal mire. So Sri Aurobindo says so beautifully about human mind. So he has observed everything. He has seen life. He has received 100,000s of letters where every devotee is writing his own problems, this thing. So that is always there. His moss is buried in the animal mire. A strange animosity is his nature's rule. So she goes on like that. Now I have to see how far I have in time. No. So again we will come to some of the beautiful lines. In between I will leave because there is no time. He has no certain light by which to walk. Just, I will not explain, we will have a reading. His life is a blind man's buff, a hide and seek. I love this. These lines are very, anyway, they are a mirror to you actually. Each person can see. He seeks himself and from himself he runs. That is always there in human life. It is a reality. Meeting himself, he thinks it other than he. It is also there sometimes. Always he builds but finds no constant ground. It is also very true about human life. you build a house, you select a town, but somewhere you feel it's not the proper place for you. Every time you want to run from one thing to other. Always he builds but finds no constant ground. Always he journeys but nowhere arrives. He would guide the world, himself he cannot guide. He would save his soul, his life he cannot save. So that is the contradiction, paradox in human life. All he has learned is soon again in doubt. This is also 100% truth of human life. Actually, every time we doubt, then all is shadow again and nothing true. Unknowing what he does or whether he intends, he fabricates signs of the real in ignorance, as hitches his mortal error to truth's star. But never has he seen the face behind. A giant ignorance surrounds his lore. Assigned to meet the cosmic mystery in the dumb figure of a material world, his passport of entry falls and his personage. He is compelled to be what he is not. That is also a truth, very 100% truth. Always you are given a different job, actually. Job, I mean to say, different life to live. What you want is different and what you do is different. His passport of entry falls in his personage. He is compelled to be what he is not. He obeys the inconscience he had come to rule and sinks in matter to fulfill his soul. Awakened from her lower raven forms, the earth mother gave her forces to his hand and painfully guards the heavy trust. His mind is a lost torch bearer on her roads, illumining breath to think and blossom to feel. He labors with his slow and skeptic brain. Like that she goes on, so many things she has covered. Let not the, my light shall be in thee. Again, she assures. Now she gives Sasyopati some bull-like thing. Her source and strength she wants to give to him. She tells about the earth, the conditions, the human nature and his problems. Then again, in the end, she tells to Sasyopati, tread still the difficult and dateless path, joining the cycles with its austere curve. Measured for man by the initiate gods, my light shall be in thee. This is the promise again, one promise she says here. My strength thy force. Let not the impatient Triton drive thy heart. Don't think about the earth and all now. You go there and work. Don't ask me to come. That is, ask not the imperfect fruit. That will be an imperfect fruit if you insist on myself coming there. It is not the perfect fruit. Now I am not ready and the earth is not ready and I am not willing. Now earth is not ready. I am not willing to come. The partial praise. That will be a partial praise for you. It is not a total sampurna gift for you. It is a partial praise. Only one boon. Again she is giving a chance to him. To greaten thy spirit, demand. I will give you something to greaten your spirit. Demand. Only one joy, to raise thy kind desire, thy kind, the human being, to raise the human beings, ask something. Above blind fate and the antagonist powers, moveless there stands a high unchanging will. To its omnipotence, leave thy work's result. All things shall change in God's transfiguring hour. There is a time for us to do things, and you please leave it for us. We will do all. Whatever is possible and whatever is needed for the earth, we will do. That was the, then what he says. Now that is very important part of this thing, what Asupati says now. August and sweet sang hushed that mighty voice. Nothing now moved in the vast brooding space. A stillness came upon the listening world, a mute immensity of the eternal peace. But Aswapati's heart replied to her, a cry amid the silence of the vast. A cry came from Aswapati's. How shall I rest content with mortal days and the dull measure of terrestrial things? I who have seen behind the cosmic mask the glory and the beauty of thy face. Hard is the doom to which thou blind bindest thy sons. How long shall our spirits battle with the night and bear defeat and the brute yoke of death? We who are vessels of a deathless force and builders of the godhead of the race, or if it is thy work I do below, amid the error and waste of human life, in the vague light of man's half-conscious mind, why break not in some distant gleam of thee, ever the centuries and millenniums pass, where in the greyness is thy coming ray, where is the thunder of thy victory's wings, only we hear the feet of passing gods is telling. How can I rest content after seeing you, after seeing your beautiful power, peace, bliss, everything I have experienced. I want it for other people also, for the whole humanity, I want that. So he is asking, the glory and the beauty of thy face, hard is the doom. Again he is telling about the human beings. We are binded by earth and ignorance, death. All these things are there on earth. The gods are leaving us like this. They are not coming. Only passing phase is there. Some god comes and goes, but no permanent. This change is there and they are process. There is nothing permanent is happening. So only we hear the feet of passing gods. Gods are coming and going, but there is no permanent change on the earth. There is no permanent transformation. Death is still ruling on the earth, he says. Till all is done for which the scene was made. Again he is telling, too little the strength that now with us is born. We are not that strength. There is no might in us. We are only ordinary, fragile human beings. Too faint the light that steals through nature's lid. Even the light is not subtle. Light means that illumination is not there for us. We are ignorant. Too scant the joy with which she buys our pain. Our pain is more. Only we are doing this. Some joy is being given, but it is the price. With pain, we are giving the price with pain, actually. Every joy is because of we are taking some pain. In a brute world that knows not its own sense, thought racked upon the wheel of birth we live, the instruments of an impulse not our own, moved to achieve with our heart's blood for prize, half knowledge, half creations that soon die, a foiled immortal soul in perishing limbs, baffled and beaten back with labor still, annulled, frustrated, spent, we still survive. As though we are surviving with all the oddities, with all the pressures, with all the troubles, with all the half knowledge, we are still surviving. A larger seeing man with noble heart, a golden vessel of the incarnate truth, the executor of the divine attempt, equipped to wear the earthly body of God, communicant. A foiled immortal soul in perishing limbs, baffled and beaten back, we labor still. Annulled, frustrated, spent, we still survive. In anguish we labor that from us we may rise. A larger seeing man with noble heart, a golden vessel of the incarnate truth, the executor of the divine attempt, equipped to wear the earthly body of God, communicant and prophet and lover and king, I know that thy creation cannot fail. He is asking. For even through the mists of mortal thought, infallible are thy mysterious steps, and though necessity dons the garb of chance, hidden in the blind shifts of fate she keeps the slow, calm logic of infinity space and the inviolate sequence of its will. All life is fixed in an ascending scale, and adamantine is the evolving law. In the beginning is prepared the close, this strange irrational product of the mire. This compromise between the beast and God is not the crown of thy miraculous world. This is what Asopati says. Is it not the crown? I know there shall inform the inconscient cells, at once with nature and at height with heaven, a spirit vast as the containing sky, and swept with ecstasy from invisible founts, A god come down and greater by the fall. A power arose out of my slumber self, abandoning the tawdry limbs of the house, hours, and the inconstant blink of mortal sight. So he goes on like that again, explaining the state of the human being and what he wants. Then actually now he expresses his vision. Asvapati, after scaling all the planes of consciousness, had a vision about the future. He is already having that vision. So now he gives it, that vision, to the Divine Supreme Mother, so that she will understand and grant the boon. So again, now again, this is a beautiful passage in Savitri. Again, now he is putting forth his vision. I saw the omnipotent flaming poignets over the heavenly verge, which turns towards life, come crowding down the amber stairs of birth, forerunners of divine multitude. Out of the paths of the morning star they came into the little room of mortal life. I saw them cross the twilight of an age, the sun-eyed children of marvelous dawn, the great creators with wide rows of calm, the massive barrier brackets of the world, and wrestlers with destiny in her lists of will, the laborers in the quarries of the gods, the messengers of the incommunicable, the architects of immortality. Into the fallen human sphere they came, faces that wore the immortal's glory still, voices that communed still with the thoughts of God, bodies made beautiful by the spirit light, carrying the magic word, the mystic fire, carrying the dionysian cup of joy, approaching eyes of a diviner man, lips chanting an unknown anthem of the soul, feet echoing in the corridors of time, high priests of wisdom, sweetness, might and bliss, discoverers of beauty, sunlit ways, and swimmers of flowers, laughing fiery floods, and dancers within rapture's golden doors. Their tread one day shall change the suffering earth and justify the light on nature's face. Although fate lingers in the high beyond, and the work seems vain on which our heart's force was spent, all shall be done for which our pain was born. Even as a old man came behind the beast, this high divine successor surely shall come behind man's inefficient mortal face, behind his vain labor, sweat and blood and tears. He shall know what mortal by mind barely does think. He shall do what the heart of the mortal could not dare, inheritor of the toil of human time. He shall take on him the burden of the gods. Yet's deed shall touch the superhuman heights, as seeing widen into the infinite, heavy unchanged ways, still the imperfect world. The splendid youth of time has paused and failed, heavy and long are the years our labor counts, and still the seals are firm upon man's soul, and where is the ancient mother's heart? O truth defended in thy secret son, voice of her mighty musing shut heavens on things withdrawn within her luminous depth. O wisdom, splendor, mother of the universe, creatrix, the eternal's artist bride, linger not long with thy transmuting hand, pressed vainly on the golden bar of time, as if time dare not open its heart to God. O radiant fountain of the world's delight, world free and unattainable above, O bliss, whoever dwells deep hid within, while men seek the outside and never find, mystery and muse with heretic tongue, incarnate the white passion of thy force, mission to earth some living form of thee, one woman fill thy eternity, let the infinity in one body live, all knowledge wrap, one mind and cease of light, all love throb single in one human heart, immortal reading the earth with mortal, treading the earth with mortal feet, all heaven's beauty crowd in earthly limbs, omnipotence girdled with the power of God, moments and movements of mortal will packed with the eternal might, one human hour, and with one gesture change the future time, all future, change all future time, let a great word be spoken from the heights, and one great act unlock the doors of fate. This is his beautiful prayer and asking the mother, Supreme Mother, describing his vision, because man, they are ready. Some beautiful higher souls are they are ready. They are coming from those higher regions. I have seen it. So they can protect the earth. They can be hero warriors of the earth phase. They are coming. So mother, you please don't wait there. You come and bless the earth. This is what he says. Change our fate by giving him this. Now, her assurance, we will see. His prayer sank down in the resisting night, oppressed by the thousand forces that deny, as if too weak to climb to the Supreme. But there arose a wide consenting voice. The spirit of beauty was revealed in sound. Light floated round the marvelous vision's brow, and on her lips the mortal's joy took shape. Now the Divine Supreme Mother is speaking in a beautiful this thing. O strong forerunner, I have heard thy cry. One shall descend and break the iron law, change nature's doom by the lone spirit's power. A limitless mind that can contain the world, a sweet and violent heart of ardent calms, moved by the passions of the God shall come. All mights and greatness it shall join in her. Beauty shall walk celestial on the earth. Delight shall sleep in the cloud net of her hair, and in her body as on his homing tree, immortal love shall beat his glorious wings. A music of griefless things shall weave her charm. The harps of the perfect shall attune her voice. The streams of heaven shall murmur in her laugh. Her lips shall be the honeycombs of God, her limbs his golden jars of ecstasy, her breast the rapture flowers of paradise. She shall bear wisdom in her voiceless bosom. Strength shall be with her like a conqueror's sword, and from her eyes the eternal's bliss shall gaze. A seed shall be sown in death's tremendous hour, a branch of heaven transplanted to human soil. Nature shall overleap her mortal step. Fate shall be changed with an unchanging will. That is her assurance and boon is given to him. Beautiful description of the mother, her limbs about all these things. Then the flame disappears and Ashwapati, he has realized his dream. Now he is waiting for the avatar to come and at Savitri. So with this, सर्वे भवन्तु सुखिनः, सर्वे सन्तु निरामयः, सर्वे भद्राणि पश्यन्तु, मा कश्चित् दुःखभाग् भवेत्. ओम शांति शांति शांति.
This is the Satya Vani has given us a much more deeper and a vaster understanding of Sri Aurobindo's Savitri. It has been overall a beautiful 4-day session on Savitri through its mantric lines. We thank her very much and request her to please come again. A few pointers of today's talk. It's a very, very long list today. entire humanity was behind Ashwapati's aspiration, a strong forerunner. Gods want to see the fulfillment in each and every individual. We all aspire for the pure, healing, divine touch. Offer one's heart and soul for the connection. Each nerve got transformed into a beautiful thread of joy. My fire and sweetness is the cause of life. But too immense my danger and joy. This is the model. Be in the world and work for the world. Obey thy nature and fulfill thy faith. Against his spirit, all is in dire heat. That is, there is always a battle between spirit and matter. Man is a link between demigod and a beast. Take up and start in a small way, step by step. Psychic being is a progressive evolution. All things shall change in God's transfiguring hour. King Ashwapati gives his vision of the future to the mother. One shall descend and break the iron law. Beauty shall walk celestial on earth. A branch of heaven transplant to human soil. And for all of us, fate shall be changed by an unchanging will. Well, we thank all of you once again, and to remind you that our next program is on 28th February, next Wednesday, in the evening from 5 to 6:30, this hall itself. There will be a video presentation on Aurobindo, Integral Yoga and the Future of Mankind by Sri Shraddhananandi. All are welcome for the same. And we close this session with 2 minutes silence.